Well, hello YouTube. My name is Giovanna Fiore and this is my brand new channel, my very first video, and I'm super excited to get going on this adventure into YouTube land. This lovely converted garage is the space where Giovanna Designs was born. And so welcome. I hope that you will like it here. Hang out with me for a little bit, subscribe, and you know, we can get to making some beautiful art together. I figured that for my very first video, the best thing to do would be a complete tutorial on the Dutch pour method. I am really, really obsessed with Dutch pours at the moment. It's kind of just my thing. It's what I do, pretty much all that I do right now, because I just find Dutch pours to be absolutely beautiful. If you have no idea what I'm talking about, well, first of all, I'm going to teach you how to do it, so stay tuned and stick around. And then after you watch my video, go and check out Rinske Downa. It's R-I-N-S-K-E-D-O-U-N-A. She's the creator of the Dutch pour. She is absolutely incredible artist. Really, really beautiful work. And you will, I don't know anybody who doesn't love her stuff. Anyway, like I said, you don't know me. I'm brand new here. So I figured that a good way to get off on the right foot would be to show you a little bit of my work and to do a giveaway. And the way to enter would be to subscribe, of course. Like this video, subscribe to my channel, and that will get you two entries into the giveaway. So let me show you just a few quick pieces of my work. I'm not going to take a lot of time on this because I know some people don't like the chit chat, so I'm going to make this fast. But I did want to give you an idea of my style since you've never seen me paint before. So this one, I really, really love the way this one came out. Teal is my ultimate favorite color. Teal, blues, greens, I think that's a lot of people's favorite colors. And that's this one too. I hope that you don't get the glare on that because this one has already been varnished and the first one wasn't. Most of them haven't been varnished yet. I get into a point where, you know, I varnish things in batches. And so I haven't done that. Okay, this one was the purple one that I really, really liked. This was more towards the beginning of my painting style. It's a little more rounded. I find that I have a little more sharp edges these days. Excuse me, my throat's getting a little dry. So to show you a few bigger pieces, this one is my take on the fire and ice challenge. I think that a lot of people did their versions of this. This one sort of reminds me of the Game of Thrones, the two dragons fighting. I don't know why. It's just, I'm a huge Game of Thrones fan, so maybe that's it. A couple of bigger pieces than that even. These are 16 by 16s. This is my red dragon. It reminds me of a Chinese dragon. I don't know. You know, a lot of Dutch pours are more flowery and they have more rounded edges. I find that my work doesn't. It looks like fire or dragons. That's my style. That's who I am. This one is really interesting to me because the lacing in the cells came out really pretty. The purple and pink is just, I don't know, it's a great combination. And I have three little girls, so my entire house is covered in purple and pink, my poor husband. And so I still haven't decided if I would like for it to be oriented this way or this way. Give me your opinion. Vote in the comments. Let me know what you think. One or two. And you know, at the end of the video, also, I forgot to mention this, I'm going to show you my biggest piece ever. It's a 3 foot by 3 foot. That is my all-time favorite piece ever that I've ever done. But this is the second favorite. This is my green goddess. I just love this one. I was in a green mood, and I just think that phthalo green has such a richness to it. It just came out really, really pretty. So that's it. Like I said, I'm not going to take up a lot of time with this. I will show you the giant one at the end, but it takes a minute to get it down off of the rack. So we are going to get started now. Oh yeah, let's have some fun. I'm going to stop the video here, do my setup. I won't flood the canvas though. I will wait to show you how I do that because I know some people don't, you know, they skip straight to that and the beginners are going, what happened? I don't know how to do that. So yeah, so I'm going to flood the canvas and with you. I will be right back after it's all set up. And we're back. You know it's serious when the hair goes up because you don't want to get hair in your painting and you don't want to get paint in your hair, and I've done both of those things. So, first thing you want to do is to set up your canvas properly. Take your bottoms. You want to have a nice, clean, white backing when you take, when you finish your painting and you take the tape off. After you tape up, take a popsicle stick and run it along the sides. The other thing that you want to do is get it off of your tape. You can actually take cups, easiest way, and just pop it on top of cups. Or you can attach these big giant mamajamas, the push pins. I really love the eye hooks. because they have, if you can see that, they have screws on them because you have to have your canvas level. This is super, super important. Trust me on this one. It makes it a lot easier to level my canvas if it's not level, to adjust it by taking little screws and screwing one a little tighter, one a little looser, checking the corner, making sure that you've got it down. Because what you need to do is then afterwards make sure that everything is perfectly level. And this way, crossways, everyways. Because you don't want your paint to slide off. Sometimes when you're new, you're watching them and you see that the paint looks sort of ripply, or it's thicker in one place and thinner in the other, and you're wondering to yourself, how is that not drying like a big goopy mess? Well, these are self-leveling paints. And so what happens is as they're drying, they smooth out to a nice even level. The problem with that is if you don't have a level canvas, or if your table isn't level, that's the other thing you want to absolutely 100% check. Wherever you're going to have your painting drying, that surface needs to be level. Because once you put your painting down and you walk away from it and you leave it there, it will now self-level. If your painting is just even the slightest bit off level, the paint is going to do what? Slide on off of your canvas. And it is the worst feeling in the world to come back to your table the next morning after you're done painting and the composition is completely messed up because now your paint has slid all over the place and you just, oh, I had a gorgeous painting. What happened to it? So, level. It's a basic thing, but you got to do it every single time. So, let's get past that now. You can cover your canvas with whatever base color you like. White is sort of standard, black is sort of standard, but you can do blue, you can do green, you can do pink, you can do yellow, whatever you like. Today we're going to do white because I want to do blues. The blues are going to really pop off of that white background, and I love a lot of negative space. So let me go over our colors. The first one is going to be Liquitex Basics in Phthalo Blue, and the next one is Primary Elements Blue Bayou. Now, if you don't know what primary elements are, you are going to absolutely fall in love with these once you get started with them. It is a dry paint system with pigmented powders. So, if you can see this, I don't know if you can see the sparkle, you probably can't. Cameras really cannot grasp the beauty of these guys. And they have interference is in them sometimes. There's a whole, God only knows how many colors there are. There's probably about 200 colors. It's incredible. But what the beauty of this is you can control exactly what you're creating. You can take this and use it as is. You can take this and mix it with this and create a whole new color. And sure, yeah, you can mix regular paints, but these are just, they take painting to a whole nother level. They are a whole nother level of gorgeous. Trust me, they sparkle and shine and shimmer in the sunlight and they're just beautiful. And then if you put a coat of resin on top of them, they just completely explode and come to life. So you're gonna love these. The next one is Amsterdam in Sky Blue Light. Love that one, very pretty color. And then again, another color art, Primary Elements. This one is Sky Blue. Now, the other thing about Primary Elements is that sometimes, because they're pigmented powders, when you then mix them with your pouring medium, they don't look exactly like they look in the container. Once you mix the pigments with whatever pouring medium you're going to use, sometimes it changes a little bit from what you expect it to be. The best thing to do, in my opinion, is then when the first time that you use it, take just a little drop, pop it on the top of the cap. And that way then, when you're going back to reference it, you can make sure that you're picking exactly what you want. Let me give you a perfect example of that. Sorry for my reach. This one is Mystic Blue, and that looks like sort of a tealish, bluish color. But if you look, it's much more green once it's mixed together in person. So if you're going to go for a blue and you grab this guy and you go, oh, wait a second, that's a green. You don't want to do that every single time you go and grab a color. So pop that color on top and then you will be set for the next time you're going to paint. The next one is Payne's Gray from Pabeo Studio Acrylics. This is Payne's Gray is an interesting color. There are so many different versions of Payne's Gray. I have another Payne's Gray from Amsterdam. It's completely gray. This Payne's Gray is a very, very blue undertone. So you want to pick out the Payne's Gray that you're looking for. It depends on what your goal is there. So the next one is Robin's Egg from Color Art. This is the Extreme Light Bling It Pastels. Really pretty. It's much more of an interference color than, if you can see, it's completely transparent. but it's much more of an interference color than just a solid color. Next one is Artist Lofts Metallic Cobalt Blue. That's a gorgeous color. Again, as I said, teal is my favorite thing, and I love it. Iridescent Precious Gold from Pabeo Studios. This one is one of my favorite golds. And, you know, golds are like whites. There's like 50 different versions of them. A lot of people love that 24 karat gold by Deco Art. I tried it. I don't like it. It's too grainy for me. It's not my thing. Generally speaking, I like a finer grain so that it's a little bit more smoother of a color. I find that the 24 karat gold sometimes takes over and takes over on top of other colors. And so I'm just not a fan of that one. Okay, so that's our colors. Let's get going. So we're ready to spread our base color around. Now, there's several different ways that you can do this. You can spread around with just your popsicle stick that you're stirring with. You can spread around with a silicone spatula. This is a cake spreader, scraper. And you can use that to spread your paint around, whatever you're the most comfortable with. What I learned from Rinska is one of her techniques is to blow it around with the hairdryer and get it spread out that way. So that is what I like to do. So don't be afraid of the hairdryer. You're about to use it to do pretty much everything. So, okay, let me got a little something in paint. Not good. We don't want anything in the white paint. Okay, here we go. This is really weird for me, to be honest with you. I am so used to blasting my music while I'm painting that it's kind of a little strange to just be talking to a camera and nobody else in the room. Unnerving, to be honest with you, but I'll get used to it. And while I'm doing this, I kind of want to thank a few different people. My husband, number one, for supporting just about everything that I've done when it comes to this art adventure. All kinds of supplies, giving up his garage space, everything, time. And also, Shelley R. and Deb F. You guys supplied me with some canvases when I was first starting out, and it was really appreciated. I'm going to give you a countdown to mute your TV because I don't know how to do that in the editing process, and this might be a little bit loud. I'm not sure how it works with the microphone. So what I'm going to do is blow around on the low setting and the cold setting. You don't want to use the hot because you don't want to heat up the surface of your paint. You can get that skin on your paint. Bad idea. Okay, ready? 3, 2, 1. If it's not that bad and you can hear me, what I'm doing is aiming the paint towards the center and working it around until I can get it to flow really nice. And what you want to do is keep your hairdryer aimed down and not that way, because then you're going to be painting your walls. Okay, we're good. You're going to end up with a lot of air bubbles. Blowing your paint around is going to do that. Even mixing your paint is going to do that. So what you need is a culinary torch. Yes, you can get a heat gun. Don't do it. This is really for resin work more than anything else. Again, you're going to heat up the surface of your paint. And you want to go not too close, not too far. Start up high if you're not sure what to do. Get a little closer to the bubbles, and when they start to pop, now you know you're at the right distance. Okay, quickly move around as quickly as you can. Gosh, I had a lot of air bubbles. Got something in my paint. What is in my paint? You do not belong there. Get out. All right, get any little goobers or hairs or anything that you see out now, because you don't want to be blowing that around. Covering your sides is super important, but don't get crazy with it. You don't have to spend 20 minutes making sure that all of your sides are perfect. You just want paint on them so that when you do blow your paint around and it hits the sides of your canvas, it's not hitting a dry surface. Okay, so just take your fingers or a tool that you like and spread it around. And you know, can use new paint, but the paint has already dripped off onto the table, so you might as well use that. All right, sorry. Fly, get out of here. You're not invited to the party. These are the trials and tribulations of working in a garage. You're going to get these little critters from time to time. And if you've noticed, I'll talk while you're staring at the top of my head. Sorry about that. If you've noticed, I am on the floor. Now, there's a reason for this. I have a horrible back, and leaning over a table doesn't work for me. So for me, standing up and getting certain leverage that way is easier. I also have a cushion on my knees. So we are good there. Hey, it's time to paint. This is always the fun part. Okay. So I'm going to start with, line your colors up ahead of time and have a plan going in. It's going to make it easier for you once you're here. At this point, you don't want to look at the canvas and go, uh-oh, what do I do now? So you want to take your colors, line them up in the order that you're going to pour them. It'll make your life a lot easier. And again, like I said, have a plan going in. Now, it's never going to work out the way that you expect it to. You're never going to be able to blow the paint exactly the way you want, but at least you have an idea as to what your goal is, and then you can tweak it. Something this big, you can't just do one puddle in the middle and then blow it out. It's just, you're not going to cover the canvas at all. So there's several different ways you can do that. Several puddles, or you can do lines. You can do a whole bunch of different things. I'm going to do three different puddles on this one because I want to do that blown out, like I said, more like that green one. And that's what I did there. So, and I have a lot of different colors, so I'm not going to go too crazy with how much. I'm going to try not to. I have a tendency to do that, to go too crazy with how much paint I'm actually putting on the canvas. Okay, that was the phthalo. Here are your primary elements. You really can't overdo it with the primary elements. They're just so gorgeous. Like I said before, you know, it's just, now you can swirl around. It doesn't have to be exactly in a puddle. This is really your party. You can do whatever you want, but you'll see what you know, what you get comfortable with and what you like and what you don't like in the results. Okay, let's get some Payne's gray for contrast. I want the contrast a little bit here and a little bit there, so I'm going to spread this one around. And these are a lot of blues all together, and so you want something to sort of break it up. Okay, here's my lighter primary elements. And I'm putting a lot of paint on this canvas, but it'll be okay. We'll see. Now you can put a little bit over here and a little bit over here and a little bit over there. And, you know, if you put just the color on one side, you're going to get more of a concentration of that color in that one area. So you can also plan out where you want your bursts of color to be. And I say plan loosely, you know, you're only gonna get so far. And then your metallic. Whew. Wow, that was a lot of gold.
Well, it was bound to happen. My phone ran out of memory space and completely missed the entire painting. Figures that this would happen on my first video, but if I've got to get this problem out of the way now, so be it. So I made a really pretty painting. I wish you would have seen it. So what I'm going to do is, you know, it's kind of ridiculous that you didn't see any of it. All you saw was me putting down puddles of paint. So what I think I'm going to do is take this, put it aside in the drying rack, and then start over. But I want you to see the process. I mean, that's kind of the whole point of watching a tutorial, is to see the process of the actual painting, not just me pouring puddles. It's kind of stupid. So yeah, hang on. I'll be right back after I do this all again.
Okay, I'm back. Man, that took a long time. Interruption from kids. I had to do this entire thing over again, so don't mind me if the lighting is a little bit different, because it's a different time of day. Just like before, we're going to flood the canvas, meaning that you're going to pour your white around your colors. Now, reason why we're going to do that is because we're blowing the white over the colors. And we're blowing the white over the colors to mix them just a little bit before we blow them out. Now, some people don't do that. Some people are blowing them straight out like this. I like it softer a little bit. I like it to be, that's just my style. Everybody's style is different. You gotta figure out what works for you. Here we go. Okay, got my arm there. So I don't know if you noticed the way that I was holding the hair dryer, it does make a difference. As you can see, I aimed it a little bit too far over in one direction and I got my arm. You don't want to paint your walls. So you want to take the hair dryer and go straight down until you start to see the paint move. And then you work it in, angle it just a little bit until you're getting it where you want it. And what I like to do is I go like this and go up. Take it away from the canvas so that you're not doing exactly what I just did. So do what I say, don't do what I do. Every mother's mantra, right? Okay, one more time. And we're ready. Okay, here we go. I like that. Yeah. Ooh, I like that. Oh, this came out even better than the other one. This is what I was going for. I was going for really this deep blue. Where is it? Here we go. This deep blue to sort of take center stage. And in the other one, my metallic cobalt blue took center stage. And I love that color, don't get me wrong, but it just wasn't what I wanted for this painting. Oh, it's so pretty. Okay, so now this may be where you stop. I don't. I mess with every little itty bitty detail of this. I don't like it this curved and flowery. I like it with, like I said before, a little bit of a fiery edge to it. But as you can see, the cells are starting to form, the lacing is happening, and so we are going to encourage that with a little bit of heat. What you want to do is go down in the areas where you see that there's paint under the white. So like right here, it looks very pale, but I see something happening. So I'm going to encourage that with the heat. And you see that? That's gonna pop up now. Over here, same thing. Over here, same thing. Now, if you go into an area that doesn't have any paint underneath, what you're going to get is that you're basically burning your top layer of paint away in a way, not in a bad way, but you're gonna get that white speckly lacing to happen. So if that's what the look you're going for, then that's what you want to do there. Okay, let's see what happens in the middle here. A little bit more over here. See that up there? That's what I was talking about. The little baby cells. They're like little white laciness to it. Oh wait, what's happening over here? What are you doing? Cool. Okay. Time to get serious and let's mess with it. Like I said before, please excuse the top of my head, but I'm going to be bending and stretching in all kinds of weird. So, oh, one of my mics went out. See? One of my mics went out. See, I messed it up already. Okay. So, first things first, I don't want these little splatter guys. Now, the way you get rid of anything you don't like is to do exactly what I'm doing here. Because this paint, that little blue paint, that's sitting right on top of the white. So what you're doing is you're dabbing that top layer away and getting rid of it and taking it off, and the white is just staying underneath. So you can sort of erase what you don't like. Oh gosh, I really like this. Okay. Ah, hand in the white paint. It's to be expected. So what you want to do is take the areas that you like and stretch them with the way that you're blowing. You can blow from the center, you can blow from the edges, whatever you want to do to make it your own. Ooh, those cells can stretch. Look at that. I love it when they do that. Oh yeah, I like that. Okay. There we go. Stretch those cells out a little bit. And I'm blowing on the darker blue because that's what I want to accentuate. So that's going to take over a little bit more even. Pretty. Okay, what else do you like? Let's see what other edge I can go for. That's better. I like that. Let's see. Oh, I really love the center. It's just the gold is right in the center. It's so good. Let's make that bigger. Oh, yeah. Do you see what I mean? You don't have to save the blowing just for your edges. You can go into any area that you like and just work it. All right, what else are we doing here? Let's see. I don't like that. Yes. Okay, so here's another thing. If it's not moving where you want it to go, that means there's no extra paint on the outside of it to make it able to flow. So you just want to add a little white and then blow on it. Pretty. I am so happy with this. I really like it. Okay, still not crazy with this top edge over here. You're too harsh. All right, let's add some white to you and figure you out. What are you gonna do? Sure, go blow over the edge. Interesting, because this is all white now and that's all blue. Too much blue. Get back in with my white. That's better now. It's a little more organic looking. And look at that. I'm going to get cells under there. Unbelievable. Hello. That happens sometimes too. All right. I want a little bit more color here. Can I get you to move? Hmm. Oh yeah, blow that one backwards. That's good. It's not going to be much more than that is. Okay. Okay. Oh my gosh, I really love this. Okay. Something's a little off, and I think it's this. I think we need to blow that out a little bit more that way. Yes. Yes. That's much better. Much better. I like it. I like it a lot. Okay. I'm stopping. I'm good. Oh my gosh, I love it. This makes me super happy. Super happy. Wow. For my first pour, I'm so excited that this came out so well. I hope you love it too. Okay, I'm gonna stop now, take the camera off the clamp, and show you all the little details. Okay, so here we go for some details. Sorry for the ring light reflection and the shadow of my phone, but I'm working with what I've got so far. So here are those little cells and then some big ones. My marbly looking center. And I love these guys. I love these little clusters of cells. Little cell families. You know, I don't usually get a lot of cells in my work. And that's okay. I mean, this is actually one of the rare times that I did get, you know, something like that. I mean, I don't know if I call those cells so much. They're sort of craters. But yeah, I get more things like this. Like the little baby clusters of cells, which I really love. I just think that the more detail in a painting, the better. And I don't really think that, you know, the Dutch pour, the goal of the Dutch pour is to have a whole bunch of cells. I mean, if you get them, they're sort of bonus cells because you're not really aiming for that. You're just aiming for a really flowy, pretty picture. That's more, you know, the swipe or some of the other techniques. But I think that that's that. I want to thank you so much for joining me. Please hit that like and subscribe button. It would really help to support me in this new YouTube channel, and I hope to see you in the next video. Thanks a lot. Bye-bye.